Welcome to the CCFR Radio Podcast, your source for news, updates, and stories from the CCFR.
Hey everybody, welcome to episode 19 of the CCFR Radio Podcast. I'm your host, Rod Giltaka. Thanks for joining me again today on the show. We will get a quick update on Bill C-71, some of the things that the CCFR is doing about it, some of the things that you can do about it, and we'll have part two of my interview with Bob Zimmer concerning Bill C-71 versus Bill C-75. Things are getting really weird out there. I don't know what in the world the government is thinking. But anyways, it'll be good for a laugh or a cry, depending on how optimistic you are. All that and more heading your way right after this.
Hunters and sports shooters have a lot more in common than they think. Politicians and bureaucrats will never stop pushing toward their vision of Canada where only the police and the military have firearms. All gun owners need to stand together. An attack on one is an attack on us all. Let these people know they do not have your consent. Stand up for your own ability to own and use firearms. Donate now or become a member of the CCFR at www.firearmrights.ca.
All right, welcome back, everyone. Stepping back and looking what our community has done regarding Bill C-71, I'm encouraged. A lot of letters have been written, a lot of phone calls were made, so that's great. But I will say that there's a lot of work left to do, so I want to chat about this for a minute real quick. All right, the biggest thing right now is continue the phone calls. If you haven't called your MP in the last 7 to 10 days, call them again. You got to keep calling them every 7 to 10 days until they call you back. And that's really important. I'm sure that the overwhelming majority of us in the community have made one or two phone calls and they were like, God forbid they ever actually call me back. They probably won't. Well, it's almost 99% chance that they won't. But in case they do, you know, you'll have to have a somewhat meaningful but short conversation with them. And I know that people don't want to have that conversation because it's conflict, right? And I don't like conflict either. The only reason I do conflict all the time is because these people have left me no choice but to do it, right? So don't be afraid of that. It's not really conflict anyway, because all you're doing is, if God forbid they call you back, you just have to say, well, listen, I want to hear it from you. Why are you supporting this bill? If we all agree that gangs, or hardened criminals, career criminals are who's doing all the shootings, then can you tell me what part of this bill directly addresses that? Or are you regulating a group of people that are already overregulated and have shown they do not represent a disproportionate threat to public safety? So I'm going to give you a couple of factoids should you need them in a second. So please make sure that you make these phone calls. I know they're not easy, but it's 3 minutes of your time, and I know it's difficult to kind of just make yourself do it, but please do that. We have to keep the phone calls up. We have to cause them as much trouble and as much frustration and as much stress as we possibly can, because what they're doing is wrong and we hold the moral high ground. There is no way around that. The facts don't support the other side of this argument. So you're right. Let's just keep up the pressure. So really appreciate that for everybody that's doing that. And if you haven't done it, please call. Remember, only call the constituency office. Don't call their Ottawa offices. They have resources there. Call the constituency office and tell them you want to call back. Right? I want to call back. So anyway, please continue to do that. Another thing that we can do is we have the Bill C-71 petition. I think it's 1608. E-1608. So that petition is currently sitting at 72,305 signatures, which makes it the second largest petition in the government's e-petition system in history, basically. So the number one, now this is important, and I want to mention some. There's even been some prominent people in the firearms community who have said, oh, don't even sign the petition. In fact, I encourage you not to sign it. It's counterproductive. Just ridiculous, okay? And I'm going to tell you why in a second. But anyway, I just, you know, people encouraging members of the firearms community to not be active is, and they're calling signing a petition counterproductive, right? Anyway, I got to deal with this stuff all the time. So anyway, what would be great is if this petition would be the most signed petition of e-petitions in Canadian history. Now, the number one most signed petition that's on there right now is the one on electoral reform, which was ended at 130,452 signatures. So we're about 52,000 signatures short to tie that one. And I think we can do it. So why is this important? It's important because we're creating, number one, we're telling the government this is wildly unpopular. We're trying to cause turmoil within the party because this is just wrong. And they're not getting a stinking free pass from me, and they're not getting a stinking free pass from the rest of us. That's why, for one. And for two, one of the tenets that they've been resting on is that, oh, this is a widely supported bill. Nothing could be further from the truth. The bill is a piece of garbage, an absolute embarrassment to the majority Liberal Party, right? To the official majority, an absolute train wreck. It couldn't have been worse. But anyway, we offered to help. They didn't want our help, and we would have been happy to help them, but whatever. They made their bed, and now they're going to lie in it. So we want to make sure that they can never, ever say that publicly without having somebody throw that number in their face. Well, the petition was the largest in Canadian history, got 142,000 signatures. I don't think that that's right, Minister. Right? So we're creating our own data points. We're creating our own real facts, right? So that's why it's important to actually get that petition out. And we can throw that, we can drop that on people, right? I'm always a big proponent on dropping facts on people. You know, they come with some ridiculous, irrational, completely disconnected with reality position on a topic. You go, oh, here's some facts, boom. Here's Stats Can, boom. You know, here's an e-petition signed by 140,000 Canadians, the biggest one in Canadian history, saying that they don't want this, boom. What else do you have? And they got nothing. They have nothing, right? They're just ideologues that are trying to get more involved in your life and to hurt you more. And they won't, then they can't be reasoned with, unfortunately. And I get a little bit emotional when I talk about this stuff because it's just bad behavior and we just keep having to put up with it in government. And, you know, there couldn't be a worse place to have bad behavior, right? Is in governments or bureaucracies. So anyway, that's why it's worth it. Now, how are we going to do it? Just get everybody you possibly can. Ask your buddies at the gun clubs. If you're a member of a gun club, talk to the executive or send an email. Just go, hey, can we send this petition out over the mass email system in our gun club? We need to send this to members. We need to get that out. We need a big number there, which will really help us in our argument. So everybody you possibly know, get your niece and your nephews and your brothers and sisters and parents and aunts and uncles, get everybody to sign this that will sign it. Really, really important that we do that. Okay, so that's the deal. Now there's a project coming up with the CCFR, hopefully that'll bump those numbers up even higher. And if we can achieve the most signed petition in Canadian history, that's worth doing. Okay, because it doesn't cost anybody a penny to do it. So absolutely worth our time. Anyway, there was a story on CPAC about Bill C-71, and I'm going to put the link in the description box below or in the show notes. And the CCFR was formalized in that CPIC story, so that's awesome. The interesting part is that they actually have a firearms timeline. It's very summarized. By no means is it complete, but it's kind of interesting. So at the bottom, where they detail how many PAL holders there were in 2016, they also detail how many licenses were revoked. Now, this is an interesting little factoid, and this goes back to the conversation I was talking about having with your MP if they supported this trash bill, which is, can you demonstrate to me that PAL holders in Canada represent a disproportionate threat to public safety? So there are the numbers right there on the CPAC site in the link below. I think I'm going to label it CPAC link. Okay, so you can go there and you can see the CCFR is prominently placed in, you know, the people that oppose this bill, and a link to the parliamentary press conference. If you haven't watched that, I would highly encourage you to watch it. Really, really interesting. But they stated right in the bottom that there were 2,070,000 PAL holders and 2,200 revocations. If you do the math on that, it ends up to be 0.1% had revocations. Okay, 0.1%. And if you're familiar with the system like I am, those out of those 2,200 revocations, which, you know, how many of those were an actual threat and weren't administrative or documentation punishments, which were not divorces, where some, you know, some threats were made in anger, you know, or inappropriate things were said. Who knows? Probably 2,000 of those didn't represent actual threats to public safety. And the last 200, and this is not qualified. This is not the qualified part, but I'm just, based on my experience, you know, and probably 200 were people that really needed their licenses pulled. Because are there people that have a license that need them pulled? Absolutely there are. There's some bad people out there, and they can get through the system if they haven't had any criminal activity documented, no criminal record, and they can pass the test, sure. But it's a very, very, very tiny minority. So anyway, good thing for you to know that less than 1/10, well, 1/10 of 1%, not less than that, slightly larger, 1/10 of 1% have experienced a revocation. So 99.9% of gun owners are absolutely law-abiding citizens, says the government itself. Now, on openparliament.ca, I'll put a link for this as well. This is some other good stuff that you should know as a gun owner. Some figures were quoted by MP Candace Bergen in the debate on C-71. So just before I tell you about that, C-71 has made it through the second reading and it's now in committee. Okay, so it's going to get debated in committee, and if it passes that, then it'll be on to the Senate. So anyway, during the debate in the House, MP Candace Bergen provided a couple of quotes. So one of them was, an analysis of a special request to Statistics Canada found that between 1997 and 2012, just 7% of the accused in firearm homicides had a valid firearms license. Okay, 7% of them, or only 2% of all accused murderers. So that's interesting now, isn't it? Right. So overwhelmingly, 98% of accused murderers were not licensed gun owners that had to do with, you know, firearms related homicide. Isn't that interesting? Again, we don't represent in any way, shape, or form, a disproportionate threat to public safety. So think about this for a second, just if you're, you know, if you want to internalize this. If PAL holders were 2% of the population, then this would be proportional, meaning that PAL holders would be equally as bad as the general population, but that's not true. That's not what those numbers say. PAL holders are about 6% of the population, three times higher. So, you know, not equally represented in, you know, bad behavior at all. So another quote from that same statements by Ms. Bergen. A person in this country who has a license to own firearm is 50% less likely to ever commit a crime with a firearm. 50% less likely. So anyway, when I say that we are the best, most highly vetted Canadians, most trustworthy and highly vetted, it's not an opinion. It's not a slogan. I'm just merely stating a fact. Okay. So there's one more quote that I want to share with you in reference to John Tory. He's the mayor of the city of Toronto. Ooh, talk about demagogues and, you know, somebody who intentionally misleads people and spends his time fooling people. It's just unbelievable, in my opinion. He noted, this is a quote, he noted that only 2% of homicide victims in Toronto had no connection to either gangs or drugs. And that, conversely, 98% of the crime that's going on has to do with gangs and drugs. Isn't that interesting? Right? You know, and if you ask John Tory, whether he, you know, he's supporting Bill C-71, he'd tell you absolutely he's supporting it, right? You know, and Bill C-71 has nothing to do with changing the behavior of gangs or those involved in drugs. So ridiculous. You know, I still, you know, and some people, you know, people that are close to me, they're like, hey, you know, why are you shocked when people lie still? I mean, you should know better. And I'm like, yeah, I totally should. But I don't know what it is about me. Maybe I'm naive or childlike. I'm still shocked when people lie, even in media, right? To large groups of people. And it's easily to demonstrate that they're lying to you or intentionally trying to mislead you. It's just, I don't know. I guess there's just a lot of sociopaths and psychopaths. You know, we live in a cacistocracy, I guess. So if you haven't heard that term before, you can look that up. That'll be an interesting little adventure for you. But yeah, I mean, just every day it's proven to me more and more that we do live in a kakistocracy. So, and that's spelled with a C. So check it out. It's rule by the least competent and the worst. That's what it is. So the worst people tend to float up to the top. And then when you have somebody good, it's usually a rejection of all those people that mislead and lie to you. And, you know, it's a last ditch effort to get somebody good at the top. And that's, and you can see the evidence of that all through Canadian politics and politics in other countries as well. So anyway, something to think about. So that's all I wanted to address in this section. Wanted to give you a couple of factoids. God forbid you are doing your own grassroots advocacy, or you get a call back from your MP and you have to engage in a little conversation with them. So hopefully that's useful. Stay tuned. When we come back, I will have Bob Zimmer for an interesting discussion on Bill C-71 versus C-75. So stay with me.
There are politicians and bureaucrats in Canada who believe honest, hardworking Canadians cannot be trusted with firearms. These people will stop at nothing to make sure they are the only ones who can possess them. Let them know you don't consent to their ongoing campaign against you. Stand up for your own ability to own and use firearms, now and for generations to come. Donate or become a member of the Canadian Coalition for Firearm Rights by visiting us at www.firearmrights.ca.
Hey, we're back. I've got Bob Zimmer back on the phone, well, on the Skype actually, and we're going to talk about another unmitigated disaster, which is Bill C-75 and how it contrasts to Bill C-71. So on one hand, they're doing, you know, the Liberals are doing one thing and they're doing the complete opposite on the other hand. So thanks for joining me again, Bob. I appreciate it.
Yeah, good to be here, Rob.
Awesome. So just to get the conversation started, we've got Bill C-71. We've talked about that last episode. And of course, it does really nothing to stop the gang shootings that everyone agrees is the issue. Certainly harasses gun owners. And then I think it was like 2 weeks later, on the heels of that, you know, where they start hammering gun owners again in, you know, in the effort to stop criminal behavior, they come out with Bill C-75, which actually lessens the consequences for some criminal behavior.
Yeah. And guess which one, surprisingly, it lessens. I've got a long list here, and it says it reduces the penalty. It's basically by adding a summer conviction as opposed to a prosecutorial option. And it's assault with a weapon is also one that they list there of that they're lessening stringency for. So it's a little bit ironic that on one hand they're tightening up laws for law-abiding firearms owners in Canada, and yet seemingly getting soft on ones that have actually committed crimes with firearms.
Yeah, the hypocrisy is it's breathtaking in its scale.
Yeah, it is.
Now it's my understanding, and I know that you're not as strong on 75 as you are on Bill C-71 either.
Yeah, it's, of course. Just to say too, Rod, the bill that we talked about before, 71, is about 20 pages thick. It's very easy to go through it in an hour or so. C-75, on the other hand, it's a book about two inches thick. It's quite a different document. It's very expansive and extensive. So we're still going through it as we speak, looking for the unintended consequences of some of the legislative proposals. But there are definite things that we know about, you know, reducing penalties. That's a definite. We know what they're doing. We have a list of things that they're doing that with. So, yeah, definitely troubling, to say the least. On one hand, they're getting tough on the good guys, and then on the other hand, going easy on the bad guys. It's hard to explain.
Well, it is. And I think for most Canadians, as is very similar with the firearms file itself, right? Most Canadians don't understand. And they're sitting there with some level of trust because apparently we're told this was going to be a very this is positive politics, and it was going to be the most transparent government in Canadian history. Certainly more transparent than the evil conservatives behind, you know, that preceded them, which is not turning out to be true at all on both parts. But it's I think people just trust the government, and unfortunately they're making a lot of bad choices.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. You know, and I understand, I think the crux of the reason for 75, and this is what they've tried to explain, is that the backlog in the judicial system or the legal system, you know, and we all see that backlog is there. It takes forever to have somebody go to court, and anybody that's been part of the process, I haven't been, but I've seen it where it takes years and years just to get your case heard. And that is a problem. I agree with that. And, you know, we understand to take measures to deal with that. We're supportive of that, obviously. But when to do that, where you're letting people out of jail without a jail free cards, I mean, that's not the way to do it. We're dealing with criminals here that should be spending time behind bars. And that's that. We're not asking for them to be let out. We're just asking for a more efficient system. And again, the way they're going is exact opposite way they're doing it with C-71.
Well, the inability to prioritize and to this, I think it's a lack of values personally, but, you know, yeah. Like it's my understanding. And again, I'm no expert on this bill as I have spent more time on C-71, but on one hand, C-71, you know, burdens gun owners with accounting for firearms, and they want to build a $1 billion infrastructure like they did before, which never saved a life. And then on the other hand, they're saying we want to make sure that Crown prosecutors, depends what province you're in British Columbia, it's the Crown that approves charges and proceeds with them. You know, we need to give them more latitude to be able to issue or move forward on a summary conviction. For things like weapons trafficking or terrorism or even hiding a body, which is a criminal offense. You can't, if you kill somebody, especially in this context with this bill, an infant, it's a separate offense if you hide the body from police. And they're saying, well, oh, we've been way too hard on the people that are hiding these infants' bodies. And I just... I just, you know, it's funny because, you know, obviously people come to me all the time and they're like, what are they trying to do? And I'm like, I don't know. I don't know.
Well, it's whether they didn't look at the fine print when, you know, they went in and said, okay, this is what I think probably happened is the government went into the bureaucratic group there and said, look, we need to deal with this backlog and fix it. And so the bureaucrats came back and said, okay, here's the way to fix it. And they just said, okay, instead of looking at with, again, a fine tooth comb and saying, look, there's a lot of bad stuff here. You know, one of the things that they proposed too is to eliminate consecutive sentences for human trafficking. And consecutive sentence, most people out there know, it's just, it's like a Lego block. It's back to back. So you'll serve one term of whatever 5 years, you have to serve another one after that, and et cetera, to eliminate that.
So they would always be concurrent?
Well, that's one of the proposals that they're making in C-75. That's just one of many. But even that is troubling, especially if you're the victim of human traffickers and somebody gets out in 5 years, you still have to face the person that put you, that sold you. And you might have to watch him walk down the street in front of you. And he may not even be a better person. He might still be, he served his time, but still walking the streets. And that's not what the justice system is supposed to take care of its citizens and put criminals behind bars and keep them there. Certainly redeem them were redeemable. Nobody's saying that nobody can be redeemed or helped that way, but this goes the wrong direction in making Canadians feel safe. I think most Canadians need to understand what really is going on here. And again, letting the door out or opening the door to criminals and letting them walk free when they should be behind bars is to me the wrong way to go, for sure.
Well, I would imagine this conversation is getting a little bit more philosophical, which, I mean, you know, I'll indulge myself anytime in a philosophical discussion, because that's the answer a lot of times to what's gone wrong in our country for a long time, is that we've lost our way. But I might think that part of the problem with this clogged up justice system is the fact that we're just completely overregulated as a society.
It gets to be that way. And, you know, regulations, I always say regulate where necessary. You know, I'm not one of the ones proposing to have no regulation. You know, we can see in certain stock market issues, even from the 2000s there, that there wasn't enough regulation in certain cases. But, you know, regulate where necessary, but don't overregulate. You know, you can't see the forest for the trees anymore when you see somebody that should be behind bars, but you're saying, well, just to clear up a bureaucratic backlog, we're going to let somebody who's going to victimize somebody else, especially when you talk about people dealing with, sexual assault of kids and those sorts of things. There's no room for having those people back on the streets when they shouldn't be, and to be able to victimize people. I've heard far too many stories in my job of even local, of my constituents who are affected by that very thing. And they have to see the person that victimized them walk the streets. And it's a terrible thing. I'll just list some of the other ones that, again, this is the adding summary conviction as opposed to prosecutorial option. It's assault with a weapon is one. Participation in an activity or terrorist group. Leaving Canada to participate in an activity of terrorist group. Punishment of rioter and concealment of identity. Breach of trust by public officer. Municipal corruption. Selling or purchasing office. Influencing or negotiating appointments or dealing in offices. Prison breach. Assisting prisoner of war to escape. Obstructing or violence to or arrest of officiating clergymen. Keeping common body house, causing bodily harm by criminal negligence, bodily harm, impaired driving causing bodily harm. The list goes on and on and on. And these are the things they're trying to make, streamline the process for that. And again, it's concerning. Again, we understand if that's the case, they're trying to get rid of backlogs. Anybody can understand that. But we need to make sure we're taking care of our kids. And if somebody's going to hurt our kids, they should be behind bars and not be able to hurt our kids again, or even hurt them to start with. I mean, I think they need to have a good look at this legislation. Hopefully it will get debated in the House and brought before committee. I'm assuming they're going to push it through past second reading into committee, and hopefully they'll be ready to receive changes there. But it's definitely going in the wrong direction now.
Yeah, it's. I think I said in the last interview with you that, the CCFR itself is nonpartisan, and we didn't want to be a partisan organization. But just purely because of the behavior of the Liberal government, they painted us into a partisan corner because they're completely hypocritical in almost everything they do. And certainly, I'll restrict my comments to firearms related stuff. But I mean, it's just absolute hypocrisy. We want to stop gangs by making sure that Rod needs a short-term ATT to go to the border or to go to gunsmith. And then 2 weeks later, it's like, oh yeah, we're too hard on these weapons traffickers and these people involved in terrorism within our borders.
Yeah.
I don't know what they're really trying to do. I got a roll of tinfoil that I'm trying to keep in the cupboard.
I think in fairness to your role as a nonpartisan association is there are liberals there. We know, we've heard them. we've seen, members that are liberals like John McKay and TJ Harvey, and there's many others that are from rural ridings that represent fairly conservative constituencies that we're hearing through the grapevine that they're making comments to the leadership saying, what are you guys doing? Trying to impose another firearms registry on rural Canadians when we said we weren't going to do this. They might not get reelected because of that kind of thing. So they're very concerned. And I just wish, we're here to make a difference regardless of partisanship. I think every MP should be here to make a difference regardless of what color we wear. And I wish that that the Prime Minister would see it the same way and serve Canadians rather than just do things for partisan motivation. Seems like that's just what he's doing. But he's got a bunch of people I wish he would listen to. Honestly, I wish he'd listen to his rural MPs and back down on some of this stuff, because it's not going to go over well there for sure.
Well, it seems like he's got to listen to a little more to his rural MPs. Maybe they're the only ones that still have values.
I'd really like to see...
Some of the Liberal MPs that do have values that can think this stuff through. And I know they're there, but, I wish they would stand up a little bit more, but not a lot.
And I'll say, I have friends I have friends across the aisle that are legitimate friends. I'm co-chair of the Parliamentarian Caucus with a lady named Goody Hutchings. She's a Liberal. We're like an all-party group as well, and they're good people that are trying to make sure that outfitting and firearms and fishing is still part of our history in Canada, our continued future, actually, too. So I know there's good people over there, and even I will stay out of that with them, because I think they are good people, and they're challenged with their leadership, I just hope, again, the Prime Minister listens to some of those rural folks more than he has been, apparently.
Well, you know, there's no ill wind that doesn't blow some good, because if he doesn't listen and he continues on his current path, that may make a new Conservative government possible.
Yeah, that's true. And, you know, that's definitely where we want to be, and we can get back to, you know, making some positive changes for lawful firearms owners and get some of these things corrected too, some of these justice measures that are really going the wrong direction, that we can fix them again. So nobody's perfect, but we can do our best.
Yeah, absolutely. I now I've got one more thing I thought I'd talk to you about.
Sure.
It's just popped into my head now, and let me know if this is if you don't want to talk about it, and that's okay.
Sure.
The, you know, a lot of people say, well, how come, you know, these liberal MPs don't step up? And I'm forced to explain the reality of how politics works in Canada. And I was wondering if you could get your comment on it.
Sure.
So basically what I do explain to people is, you know, let's look at a, we'll call them MP, you know, the mystery MP. Well, the mystery MP has a, you know, has a caucus position, or he's got some kind of committee position. And for every committee he's on, he makes a little bit more money. So these guys are making, let's say I live in the middle of nowhere, and I'm making whatever, I forget what the salary is, 167 or something. I looked it up on Wikipedia.
Yeah.
And then another $10,000 or $20,000 or $30,000 based on all the extra little appointments that I've gotten. God forbid I'm a minister.
Yeah.
Now, when my housing cost is very low, mine's not, because you know what it's like being in the Lower Mainland of British Columbia.
Yeah.
But if my housing costs are very low and I'm making that kind of money, when previously I probably made, you know, 60, 70, 80 grand, maybe 100.
Yeah.
And now I'm making double that. And then my party leader says they decide to whip the vote, like they're going to whip the vote on Bill C-71.
Yeah.
You know, I have to make a choice. And my choices are either I do what my party leader says, and everything's okay, and I continue to still make that money, but I'm risking actually losing my seat and losing everything. Or do I defy the leader, lose and be end up being backbenched, and God forbid I've been there for 20 years, and now, you know, I'm sitting back there with my arms folded during question period. It's a tough choice for people to make.
Yeah, I can just speak about my experience. I've never been in Liberal caucus. I've just been in our own, and we've always had open discussions about, and even back as when I first got here in 2011, it was always discussed. Any particular issues that we had was always freely discussed in our caucus, and we never felt like we couldn't say what our opinion was. So I was always impressed by that, that, you know, and not every opinion is correct, and not every opinion will be brought forward. It's just like any discussion. Sometimes you win, sometimes you don't. But I've seen things that I brought up that wasn't the flavor of the day. It wasn't necessarily popular, but eventually went through. And it's just a matter of being persistent and convincing the leadership that this is the right way to go. And I was very impressed by the fact that, you know, it wasn't going that direction, but it was a matter of just a process of conversation that the leadership was now on side and going in a certain direction. So again, I can't speak for what happens in the Liberal caucus there, but it seems more there's the line in the sand and you have to adhere to this, and there's very little discussion otherwise. A comment that's always, or a question that's asked to me, who do you represent first, your party or your constituents? And I always answer, I always represent my constituents first. Any vote, we're never made to vote a certain way, or it's always, let me say it this way, it's always the MP's decision on how we vote. If we decide to vote the way our party is suggesting, the party policy or however the direction we're going, it's our choice to vote that way or not. There's different, you know, consequences for that possibly. Like Liberals, I know they've had a few of their members pushed out of their caucus for voting against the party or not with the party. But you know, as a party, we've had the most free votes in the House when even Prime Minister Harper was there. A lot of us were accused of as being a top-down guy. But, you know, we had the most free votes in the House. You know, ironically, the NDP, who is supposed to be the most free, only had one free vote. All the rest of the votes were whipped. So I think what I've seen really play out is there's a lot of conversation, a lot of difference of opinion. And that's allowed to come to the floor and allowed to come to our group to discuss. And I've always been impressed by that. So that's just the way it works. And certain caucuses, anyway, I know I can speak for mine, but again, what's concerning me, I guess, from more with the Prime Minister is that it seems to be he has an agenda. And if you're not going to follow that agenda, then look out. And it's unfortunate that he's not listening more to those rural constituents or rural MPs that he's got.
Well, that kind of behavior is actually really, really detrimental to our country. And mm-hmm. it's very divisive. And I'm still not, I have my ideas what the plan is, but it's not going to make us a better country, that's for sure. So it's a little bit disappointing.
No. Yeah. Yeah, and I think the hope is just like you, Rod. Regardless of who's at the top, I just hope they make good decisions, honestly. And I hope with C-75 that they back down on this particular one and they realize, okay, this is bureaucratic. These ideas, just like the small business tax changes that was probably put forward by the bureaucracy too, is that, okay, once they saw it, okay, that's not a good idea, we're going to back down. And that's what I hope they do with C-75 and C-71, but we'll see.
Yeah. Well, I appreciate you talking to me about that. Like I said, I kind of put you on the spot, but
no,
I don't think it was inappropriate. Yeah. No,
it was good. It's okay. That's the stuff. I think there's this mystery behind what MPs do at times. And, you know, I'm a pretty normal guy. I was raised as a carpenter's kid. I was a carpenter myself. And I like people that look through my eyes and see what we do here. We're just all normal people trying to do our best. So the more people I can show that to, it's kind of fun. You bring them along for the ride with you.
Yeah, and I thought that was the reason why this would be useful for a lot of people that don't have an opportunity to ask, you know, an MP when they have them on the phone.
Yeah.
You know, how does all this stuff work and why do people, you know, behave in the way that they do in Ottawa?
Yeah. Yeah, no, it's still an honor to be there. Every day we get to walk through those doors, most of us are honored by the ability to do that. And there's an old saying that if you ever get tired of that view, then it's time to go. And I'm still not tired of the view.
Awesome. Well, thank you for your service. And I appreciate you taking this time with me. And until next time.
Okay. Thanks a lot, Rod.
Thank you, Bob.
Over the past 25 years, tens of thousands of Canadians have had their firearms taken by no fault of their own through arbitrary reclassifications, paperwork errors, or senseless prohibitions. The government's perfect vision of Canada does not include you or your firearms. Let Canada's politicians and bureaucrats know they do not have your consent. Stand up for your own ability to own and use firearms by joining the CCFR right now at www.firearmrights.ca.
All right, welcome back. You know what? One thing I want to say before I wrap this up is I really want to thank Bob Zimmer for coming on with me a couple of times. Bob is... he's very contemplative and very calm and, you know, very, you know, really understands the issues well and stuff. And, you know, I get a little excited sometimes. It's funny because people go, Rod, you're so cool headed. And I'm like, sometimes, you know, maybe I drink too much coffee or something. But, you know, when I talk to Bob, he just kind of my heart rate slows down a little bit. I'm like, yeah, you know, he just calms me right down. So I really appreciate that. And because if you're going to fight the long fight, you have to just temper your emotions. You have to be patient and you have to be consistent. Okay. So that's it. Consistency is the big thing. It's the big thing in fitness. It's a big thing in training. It's the big thing in politics. You have to slow your heart rate down and you got to just keep doing the things you're supposed to do. So, you know what, as it applies to what we do, we got to keep find people to sign that petition. We got to keep phoning those MPs. We don't have to get excited about it, but we have to continually and consistently push back nonstop. So don't burn up, you know, they get angry when something like Bill C-71 drops. They get angry and they, you know, they react and they're on social media and they're ranting and raving and then they cut that uncle off that's anti-gun in their family and like the hell with that guy, you know, I don't want to ever see him again. And then they burn out and then they're back to daily life. I got to go to work, you know? So the idea is just, you know, you know, ration that passionate approach off over a long period of time. So let's keep making those phone calls. Let's keep having good, rational, fact-based discussions with people. It's a long game and it's still a ways before 2019, but don't forget how badly you were burned in the last couple of months and how badly you're going to get burned in the next couple of months come 2019. Okay. Because, you know, as I might've said before, the liberals were at the lowest amount of seats that they were two election cycles ago in the history of elections in Canada. They had 34 seats. They never had less since elections started in our country. And you know what? We've tried to help them at the CCFR, you know, come up with a strategy. They didn't want any help from us. They didn't want any help from any of the other honest people that really understand this topic. They didn't want any of that stuff. It's all ideological and political to them. And we have to let them know that that's not the way you behave when someone hands you the reins of power. So save some of that passion for 2019. Save it as they try to implement this horrible trash of a bill. And we're going to make sure that they are reminded that government comes with responsibility, because there's a lot of power there and a lot of ability to affect people's lives. And it's inappropriate to abuse that level of authority, and it won't be tolerated. So let's remind them. So come 2019, make sure that you choose somebody that's going to represent you properly in the House of Commons, and make sure that you help them and volunteer and go door to door if need be and put up signs and make sure that those people get elected next election. Anyway, thank you very much, everybody, for all of your support. Really appreciate it. Hang in there. If you're not a member of the CCFR, please become a member or consider donating. And if you're curious why the CCFR, make sure you go to the CCFR website, firearmrights.ca. You can also get there by typing in CCFR.ca and click why join. And you've got a whole list of everything the CCFR has done. And there's major projects in the works right now. Also, don't forget to share this podcast. This is a really, really great way for us to stay in touch. So make sure you share it every possible place you can. All right. Thanks for your support, everyone. We will see you next time. Take care.
This is another episode of the CCFR Radio Podcast. Remember, if you don't stand up for your own ability to own and use firearms, who will? Join the CCFR or donate right now at www.firearmrights.ca.